Today we will understand the calcium metabolism. Supposing this is the body, here you have the GIT, here you have the blood, here you have the bone, and here you have the kidney. Now the calcium comes inside, this is intake, it is absorbed in the GIT, that is absorption. It is excreted in the feces. It goes from blood to bone, which is called as mineralization. And it goes from bone back to blood, which is called as demineralization. Then calcium is excreted in urine, and phosphate reabsorbed by the kidney. So this cycle is called the MacLean-Urist cycle. There are three controls of the cycle. One is parathormone, one is vitamin D, and third is calcitonin. The function of the parathormone in relation to the cycle is that it would increase calcium in the blood. Therefore, it will increase GIT absorption, increase demineralization, and increase calcium absorption from the kidney. Then the function of vitamin D is that it will increase calcium in the bone. Therefore, it will increase absorption from the GIT, it will increase mineralization, and it will increase calcium absorption from the kidney. And the third is calcitonin. Calcitonin is responsible for laying down the fabric in which calcium is deposited. So it lays down the osteoid in which the calcium is deposited. So these are the regulators of calcium metabolism. So if we understand intake, absorption, mineralization, demineralization, calcium in blood, and calcium in kidney, we have understood the calcium metabolism. Now I will proceed to tell these to you one by one. And of course, this is fetal excretion is the 3, and this let us call mineralization 3A and then 4. So intake, fecal excretion, absorption, calcium in blood, mineralization, demineralization, and calcium in kidney. This is the sequence of this lecture. Intake, 1000 milligrams. And another nutrition which must be taken with calcium is vitamin D. Otherwise, its metabolism will be deranged. And this is about 400 international units per day. So 1000 milligram. Then excretion, 300 milligrams, and absorption 700 milligrams, and let us see how that happens. So this is the lumen of the intestine. Here is the villi, and here you have the blood. So this is the cell of the villi. Now calcium in the lumen can happen in an ionic form. It happens to be in the ionic form, and this ion maintains an equilibrium with the calcium ion inside. Now if there is 1,25-OH2 vitamin D in the cell, then these two OH will be replaced by calcium and you will get calcium vitamin D. And this, there will be plus H2O because of those hydroxyl radicals. And thus this calcium is trapped and is unable to go out. This is happening in the jejunal cells. And then this calcium vitamin D will be acted on by the parathormone, and will be broken up into calcium, which will go into the blood, one, and vitamin D will be released. The absorption, so one source of vitamin D is this recycling. The other source is that the vitamin D taken in diet gets reabsorbed because it is fat soluble. The third source of vitamin D is when cholesterol gets acted on by the sun rays, vitamin D becomes available. Now this vitamin D moves through the kidney and there it gets oxalated at 24 or 25 position, OH vitamin D. So it gets oxalated at 24 and 25 OH twice vitamin D. And then it travels through liver. So in the liver it gets hydroxylated at 24-25 position. Then in the kidney it gets hydroxylated at 24 position. So now here it is a single hydroxyl group and here they become two hydroxyl groups. 24, 25, OH twice, vitamin D. Now when the calcium is less in blood and vitamin D has to act, this hydroxyl group at 24th position shifts to first position and you have 125 OH twice vitamin D, and that 125 OH twice vitamin D traps the calcium ion and results in absorption. So then after understanding this pathogenesis, let us understand the problem. So calcium can be deficient in diet or vitamin D can be deficient in diet. Secondly, vitamin D, there may be inadequate sunlight. Here, inadequate sunlight. So, calcium or vitamin D deficient or inadequate sunlight or decreased fat absorption. Or calcium not ionized. You see, calcium will be ionized in acidic medium. And acidic jejunum is acidic till the bile mixes into it. So it is the initial part of jejunum that keeps the calcium ionic, and because of stomach acid. So any gastritis which decreases the acid in the stomach would affect the ionization of the calcium and prevent its absorption. So decrease in acid is one. Then there may be a chelating agent, something which binds calcium and prevents ionization. And we have phytates in the nutrition and tetracycline as a drug which can chelate calcium and not prevent ionization. Then there may be jejunal bypass operations used to be done, gastrojejunostomy, or there may be jejunal disease like regional ileitis or Crohn's disease. So because of these things in the lumen, calcium will not be absorbed. Then there can be a problem with vitamin D not being hydroxylated at 25 position because of the liver. So there can be a liver problem. Then there can be a kidney problem where it is not hydroxylated at 24 position. Finally, in the cell itself, the 24 OH jumps to the one position and the vitamin D becomes active. So all these are causes of absorptive deficiency of calcium. And this is absorptive rickets or absorptive osteomalacia. How do you recognize absorptive rickets or absorptive osteomalacia? If there is rickets and osteomalacia, you have made a clinical diagnosis, then you give oral calcium, oral vitamin D, and the zone of provisional calcification doesn't reappear, the rickets doesn't reverse, So then you give injectable and it reverses, and that means the problem was in the calcium absorption. So this is, we have covered absorption of calcium. Now we'll cover calcium in blood. So the normal level of calcium in blood is 10. And you know that parathormone increases the calcium in blood. So calcium would increase because of parathormone, and it would decrease when parathormone increases. It increases, and this increase would sort of stimulate a decrease in parathormone, and thus this level of 10 milligram is maintained. Now if there is alkalosis in blood, ionization would decrease. So if there is a parathyroid tumor, adenoma of the parathyroid, then this would, calcium would increase. Another way is that if this is the glomerulus, this glomerulus secretes phosphate, and there is disease of the glomerulus, so GFR is reduced. Then phosphate will increase in the blood, and this phosphate will chelate calcium. That means it will combine with the calcium, ionic calcium, and therefore ionic calcium would decrease. Therefore what will happen, that parathormone will increase, and this parathormone would start drawing calcium from the bone. So there will be osteitis fibrosa cystica, multiple cysts in bone. So this is also, this whole thing is called as renal glomerular rickets, hyperphosphatemic rickets, secondary hyperparathyroidism, or renal osteo dystrophy. All these names are given to this combination of pathology. So you dealt with increase in calcium. Now when will calcium decrease? The parathyroids are situated behind the thyroid. So if in thyroidectomy you remove the thyroid, you must look at its behind sight whether you have not removed the parathyroid also. If you have, then you take out these parathyroids and implant it onto the sternomastoid. If you don't do it, calcium would decrease in blood, and when the calcium decreases in blood, it leads to tetany, hyper irritability of the nerves and muscles. It leads to congestive cardiac failure, and it leads to coagulopathy. and this tetany is diagnosed by the swastik sign, the Kaushar sign, where the muscles have gone into spasm, and this can also be associated with spasm in the feet, which is carpopedal spasm. And if you tap the facial nerves, there is the action of the facial nerve, which is called as swastik sign. So in such a circumstance, if you have removed all parathyroids, you may have tetany, and you may have to give patient parathormone for life. So this in short is calcium in blood. Now we move on to calcium in bone. For calcium in bone, you must understand that this is the amniotic cavity and this is the yolk sac, and outside it is extraembryonic mesoderm, in which there is the amniotic cavity, and all this is the embryo. So this is a bigeminal plate, and this extraembryonic mesoderm here would invaginate here and form the intraembryonic mesoderm. Therefore this will become a trigeminal plate, and this ectoderm here will become a neural tube. So this part of it is the intraembryonic mesoderm from which the bones will develop. Now therefore you have an outer layer of the amniotic plate like this. You have a part of the yolk sac which is engulfed by this layer, and you have the neural plate here like this, and you have the invagination of the intraembryonic mesoderm here, which will go and form the vertebral column, and from this will arise the limbs, which will be ectodermal on the outer side and mesodermal on the inside. So now we are looking at this mesodermal bar. We are looking at the mesodermal bar, which is to develop into bone. So this mesoderm would first convert into cartilage by a center of chondrification, center of chondrification. So this will all become cartilage. Alright. So as it becomes cartilage, there will be something which is called as perichondrium here. And since the cartilage is avascular, so because to supply oxygen to its center, blood vessels will impregnate the cartilage. Now here we have a view of a blood vessel which has impregnated the cartilage. So here is the endothelium, and this endothelium, when it impregnates the cartilage, it gets divided into a stellate cell like this, which is called as osteoblast, and it has got a granular cytoplasm. Now, what does this osteoblast do? This osteoblast lays down osteoid around it. So let us make some osteoid around it. So it's laid down the osteoid like this around it. And the second thing the osteoblast does, that it would secrete alkaline phosphatase. So this alkalinity, you know, acidity would increase ionization, alkalinity would decrease ionization, and therefore the calcium will precipitate on the collagen here. And secondly, there are phosphate ions here. So there are friends like phosphate ions, and there is alkalinity, so calcium will precipitate, and here you will have something which surrounds the calcium, will surround the osteoblast. So after this calcium would surround the osteoblast, it will also surround the blood vessels. So here it will form a small cell in which the after functioning the these projections of the osteoblast would get withdrawn, and it will become a small cell with a clear cytoplasm and a small peripheral nucleus. And this blood vessel will be here, and this will be connected with this blood vessel, but this is called as osteocyte, and this is the formation of what is called as the Haversian canal system. Then what will happen? Then there will be parathormone, and because of this parathormone, the medium here will become acidic. So as the medium becomes acidic, calcium will ionize and go back into the blood because of the parathormone. And the many small cells will combine like this, these spaces surrounded by bone would combine, and all the osteocytes here will coalesce to form one mass, and they will have large number of nuclei because every osteocyte had nuclei. So now they are known as osteoclast. So mineralization is by osteoblast, and demineralization is the result is by osteocyte, but the result is an osteoclast. So this is the process of mineralization which is stimulated by vitamin D. Here is the vitamin D, and demineralization which is stimulated by parathormone, and osteoid deposit which is stimulated by calcitonin. Orderly osteoid deposit is stimulated by calcitonin. So this would complete the calcium and bone part of it. Now we will take up the kidney. and the calcium. The kidney consists of a parenchyma, and as you know, the vitamin D is hydroxylated at 25 position in the liver. Then it comes to the kidney, and in the kidney it is hydroxylated at 24 position. So it becomes 24-25 OH, twice vitamin D. Then it goes to the jejunal cell. In the jejunal cell, the 24th bond jumps onto the one if it sees calcium. So it becomes 125 OH, twice vitamin D, which is the active form, and it combines with calcium and becomes calcium vitamin D, and the two OH bonds are released and they become H2O plus H. So if the parenchyma is destroyed, this activation of vitamin D would suffer and the mineralization of the bone would be compromised. Then you have the glomerulus. Then you have the proximal tubule. Then you have the loop of Henle. And then you have the distal convoluted tubule. And this ends up in the renal papilla. And in the glomerulus you have the glomerulus, and this is the Bowman's capsule. So the renal problem can be parenchymal, then it can be glomerular. Now when glomerulus fails, the glomerular filtration rate would decrease, and as the GFR decreases, phosphate excretion would decrease, and therefore phosphate in blood would increase. Now this phosphate would bind calcium, so there will be chelation of ionic calcium, therefore calcium would decrease, calcium ion would decrease. Now there is a watchdog on this decreasing calcium ion, and that is the parathormone. So as it starts decreasing, parathormone would increase. So when the parathormone increases, and you know the action of the parathormone by the Maclean-Urey cycle, is that it will cause increase in blood, therefore it will demineralize the bone. So there will be demineralization of the bone. Therefore you can call it renal glomerular rickets, one name. Then you can call it hyperphosphatemic rickets, hyperphosphatemic rickets, second name. Then you can call it secondary hyperparathyroidism, third name. Then you can call it renal osteodystrophy. So all the four names are of the same condition, and which is because of failure of the glomerulus and the glomerular filtration rate. So this is number two. Now we will move on to the proximal tubule. The proximal tubule absorbs glucose amino acid and phosphate. So it absorbs these things. So when the proximal tubule fails, first there is phosphaturia. Now when there is phosphaturia, phosphate would decrease in blood. And therefore when there is no phosphate, therefore phosphate, calcium would decrease in bone also. Because it's the phosphate that binds the calcium to the bone. If there is no phosphate, there will be less calcium in bone. So this is called as hypophosphatemic rickets. This is hyperphosphatemic, this is hypophosphatemic. So this is because of loss of phosphate. Now there can be loss of phosphate plus glucose. This is called as phosphate diabetes. Then there can be phosphate plus glucose plus amino acid loss. So phosphaturia, glycosuria, amino aciduria, this is called as proximal Fanconi syndrome. Then this tubule, proximal tubule, can be involved because of cysteine deposit. And this condition is called as cystinosis. The proximal tubule would become like the neck of the swan. Here is the glomerulus. So there will be a swan neck deformity. And this is called as Lignac-Fanconi syndrome. Then we move on to the distal tubule. The distal tubule is like this. Here CO2 plus H2O make H2CO3, which breaks into H ion and HCO3. This is by the enzyme carbonic anhydrase. Now this H ion would go out, and instead of this H ion, sodium, potassium and calcium would be reabsorbed in. So if you are taking a carbonic anhydrase inhibitor, like in glaucoma or in diuretics, or the distal tubule is destroyed by cadmium toxicity. Now this cadmium was found increased in water near the river Ouch in Japan, and it destroyed the distal tubule. So this disease is also called as Ouch disease. So when this mechanism is disrupted, what will happen? H ion cannot go out, therefore there will be acidosis. Calcium cannot go in, therefore there will be hypocalcemia, kalemia, natremia, hypo, all these things. And because sodium is being lost, it will take with it an obligatory volume of water. Therefore, there will be polyuria and dehydration. So, all these are features of distal tubular rickets. And distal tubular rickets would get involved either in carbonic anhydrase drugs toxicity or because of cadmium toxicity. Now we will see the combination of distal tubule and proximal tubule. So, proximal tubule plus distal tubule. That means glycosuria, amino aciduria, phosphaturia plus all the features, hyponatremia, hypokalemia, calcemia, hypokalemia, decreased water, dehydration, and because the HIN will also not be lost, therefore acidosis. Now this whole combination is called as Debré, D'Tonnay, Fanconi syndrome. Now this proximal and distal tubular deposition, like cysteine deposit, can be because of deposition of glycine. So this is also called as superglycine syndrome. So these are the tubular rickets and glomerular rickets and parenchymal rickets of the kidney. In all these rickets, alkaline phosphatase would rise. But if there is a genetic deficiency and alkaline phosphatase is low, then it is called as hypophosphatasia. So hypophosphatasia is a condition in which with rickets you find alkaline phosphatase is low. So this finishes all types of rickets. Diatic, absorptive, renal and hypophosphatasia. Thank you.